Next on Unsolved Mysteries. The charming stranger in a singles bar turns out to be a rapist and a killer. There's only one lead, and it takes police to a list of 32,000 names. What happened to the crew of the famous ghost ship, the Mary Celeste? Was it murder, a tragic accident, or something that cannot be explained? To his neighbors, he's a businessman who loves horses. To the DEA, he's an international drug smuggler. And thanks to our viewers, a violent rapist is tracked down more than 500 miles from the scene of the crime. Five cases, some without endings. Our team is working on them, and perhaps you can help. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Alexandria, Virginia.
Excuse me, is anyone sitting here?
No, go right ahead.
On a March evening, a divorced 43-year-old named Hilda Rocher meets a man at a popular singles bar.
Give me Jack Daniels Black, straight up.
Hilda later tells friends that she had dinner with the man and plans on seeing him again. But oddly, she never tells anyone his name.
Hilda had said that the guy was single, he was attractive, he had a lot of money, and she was impressed that he was driving this beautiful car. I started to tell her, don't believe everything this guy's telling you. The car is probably rented. Anybody can make up a big story. You don't know anything about him. Watch out.
1 week later, the nude body of a woman is found in a wooded area near a school. She's been sexually assaulted and then shot, execution style. Her identity remains unknown. 4 days after the body is found, police enter Hilda Rocher's apartment after co-workers report her missing.
It doesn't look like there's anybody here.
In the living room, officers find her wallet.
We just identified our victim. Got her picture on her driver's license right here.
It is now clear that Hilda Rocher is the woman who was found murdered.
360 of the room.
Evidence in Hilda's bedroom confirms that she was sexually molested.
The bed and the whole bedroom was in disarray, and we found her blouse and a pair of slacks and some pantyhose and some adhesive tape. And that's indicative of a struggle. And other evidence that we located in the room also indicated that some type of sexual activity took place.
Because there are no signs of a break-in, detectives conclude that Hilda was murdered by someone she knew.
Most detectives agree that the first 48 hours of a murder case are the most crucial. Beyond that, leads grow cold and suspects disappear. After the killing of Hilda Rocher, nearly 3 months passed before police could zero in on a suspect.
Up to you.
No, that would be great.
I'd love to.
When detectives interviewed Hilda's friends, they learned about the mysterious man that she met at the singles bar just 1 week before her death.
Hilda had told her friends that a fellow was from Florida, drove a nice car, he was a consultant for the government, and that he lived in these apartments over in Alexandria. As a matter of fact, she told her that she even went over to the apartment that evening.
The 1,400-unit apartment complex was the only clue to the man's identity. Investigators searched 3 years of lease agreements looking for any resident, past or present, who matched the description of the man that Hilda had met.
We went through approximately 25 to 30,000 files. And out of that, we come up with 32 possible names that fit the profile of the person that Hilda had described to her friend.
All police needed was one piece of evidence that could link any of the 32 suspects to the victim. 3 months into the investigation, they got their break.
My wallet's missing.
Excuse me?
Authorities learned that Hilda had lost her wallet on the night that she met the man.
She's lost her wallet, she thinks.
For some unknown reason, the man insisted that he be contacted if the wallet was found.
We said at the end?
Okay, no problem.
A few days later, the restaurant found the wallet.
Yeah, I called before you found the lady's wallet, tan, belonging to Hilda Roche.
She had called and said that he was going to bring the wallet back. And I'm saying, why did he go to the management to find out about the wallet? Why did management call him when they found the wallet? My first impression was, the guy's putting you on.
The restaurant manager couldn't remember much about the man, but she did agree to undergo hypnosis and was then able to recall a phone number.
The hypnotist told us that this would not be the exact phone number. He said, now, most of the numbers are going to be the same. They're going to be right. He says, but they might be transposed or something. You're going to have to work with it.
When detectives compared the phone number with those of the 32 apartment residents, they came up with a nearly perfect match. The number belonged to 38-year-old Gregory Barker. He had moved out of the apartment complex soon after Hilda's murder. Based on a psychological profile of Barker, along with crime scene evidence, Detective Cahill developed a chilling scenario of what happened the night Hilda Roche was murdered.
I thought you were going to come tomorrow.
Well, I have.
My wallet, thank you.
I believe that Gregory Barker came over to the house and the intention of returning the wallet to Hilda and possibly something else in mind.
Yes, come in. I'm sorry.
During his visit with Hilda, he had a violent altercation with her down in the living room. And sometime later, up in the bedroom, her clothes were taken off and a sexual activity occurred there. He, at that time, took her against her will out of the house down to the school, which is located about 9.5 miles away from the house.
Get out.
She was taken out of the vehicle and she was naked and led up a path about 150 feet through a wooded area between a housing development and a school. At which time he just brutally murdered her with a gunshot to the head. From doing a background investigation on Mr. Barker, we don't believe that this is the first murder that he committed. We don't believe that this was the last murder he committed. We believe that he could be responsible for numerous murders. We feel that possibly he could even be a serial murderer. We're very sure of the fact that he's smart and he's very dangerous.
Update. The night we profiled Hilda Roche's story, a viewer in Phoenix, Arizona, recognized Gregory Barker as a local businessman who used the alias Alex Graham. The next morning, FBI agents arrested him at his office. After standing trial in Las Vegas on unrelated charges, Barker was brought back to Virginia. A jury found him guilty of first-degree murder, and he was sentenced to 60 years in prison. Gregory Barker will not be eligible for parole until 2023. Next, what happened to the missing crew of the ghost ship Mary Celeste? On a crisp November morning in 1872, a clipper ship sailed out of New York Harbor and into legend. Her name was the Mary Celeste, the most infamous of all the ghost ships. By December, she was floating off the coast of Portugal with no one on board.
Mrs. Briggs, you must be looking for
the evening before the Mary Celeste was set to embark, her captain, Benjamin Briggs, his wife, and a guest sat down for a farewell dinner.
You'll be coming with us.
He came from a family of seafarers. He was considered quite a religious man. Captain Briggs was a noted captain. He could be stern and so on, but he was always noted as being fair.
Are you bringing the children?
Sophie will be coming with us, and Arthur will remain here in school.
The guest that evening was Captain David Morehouse. His ship, the De Grazia, was scheduled to sail for Europe more than a week after the Mary Celeste. Morehouse would soon become deeply involved in the bizarre events that were about to unfold.
Well, here's to a smooth crossing and calm seas.
God willing.
The next morning, the Mary Celeste set sail with Briggs, his wife, their two-year-old daughter, and seven crew members on board. Below deck were more than 1,000 barrels of pure alcohol, highly prized in the Italian wine trade. It was a dangerous cargo. Alcohol fumes were volatile and could easily explode. From New York, the Mary Celeste was scheduled to sail more than 5,000 miles past the Azores, through the Strait of Gibraltar, and into the Mediterranean, finally docking at Genoa, Italy. 10 days out of port, the ship was hit by a severe storm.
Excuse me, Captain.
Ma'am, I've taken in the topsails, but she's still breezing up.
The ship was battered by winds and rain for more than a week.
I'd like to take in more sail.
Let's have a look.
According to the captain's logbook, the Mary Celeste stayed on course. After 10 days, the weather cleared. In his log, Briggs placed the Mary Celeste just 6 miles off the Azores. The date of the entry was November 25th, 1872, the last entry ever made by Captain Briggs. 10 days passed.
Something strange off the starboard bow, Captain.
On board the De Grazia, the crew made a surprising discovery.
Looks like she's floundering. A couple of sails have blown away. It's a Mary Celeste.
Captain David Morehouse chose the De Grazia's first mate, Oliver DeVoe, to lead a boarding party to the Mary Celeste.
They came nearer, saw no one on deck. They thought maybe at first that it might have been what they called a fever ship. And they thought that maybe people were aboard down below dead of some sort of fever.
DeVoe discovered that one of the ship's lifeboats was missing and its compass was shattered. And he was puzzled by a long rope that snaked across the deck and off the stern of the ship. In the cabins, personal possessions, money, and gold jewelry were left behind. The captain's navigation instruments and the ship's papers were missing. But DeVoe says that he found no evidence of foul play and no reason for the Mary Celeste to have been abandoned. But one thing was certain. The ship and her cargo of alcohol could be worth a fortune in salvage rights to whoever brought her back to port. And that's exactly what Captain Morehouse decided to do.
In England, Captain David Morehouse prepared for a straightforward salvage claim in court. But Morehouse soon found himself facing government accusations that he was involved in the disastrous fate of the Mary Celeste.
And you were the first to board the Mary Celeste, is that correct?
That's right, myself and my second mate, Mr. Wright.
The government's chief investigator was a flamboyant Irishman named Frederick Solly Flood.
He was very suspicious. He had a certain bend for the dramatic, I think. He kind of immediately saw foul play. And all during the proceedings, he tried to indicate that, there had been some sort of conspiracy involved here.
And Captain Morehouse and Captain Briggs...
Flood first tried to prove that Morehouse and Briggs had planned the events in advance.
Do you think it's possible that the two of them might have been in collusion?
Sir, Captain Morehouse is an honorable man.
Yes, of course.
Faced with a lack of evidence, Flood came up with a more sensational scenario. Mutiny and murder.
And how many are empty?
Well, I found 5 or 6 right here.
The Mary Celeste was impounded, and Flood's inspectors discovered that 9 of the alcohol barrels were empty.
No, I think it more likely that the crew of the Mary Celeste opened up these casks.
Maybe we should...
In the captain's cabin, Flood found what he believed was proof of a mutiny. Bloodstains on Briggs' sword.
And what was a sword like
Flood
this?
Flood tried to prove that the crew of the Mary Celeste had broken into the alcohol and in a drunken fury, murdered Briggs and his family before fleeing in a lifeboat.
Look at the stain on the sword.
Begging your pardon, sir, but I think you'll find that to be Ross.
Well, I'll have a medical expert.
The test would later show that the stains were not blood.
Flood just absolutely refused to admit that there hadn't been a murder, but he never did get any satisfaction from the government, and they just repudiated everything that he said.
The Mary Celeste is released from custody. A salvage settlement is awarded to David Morehouse in the amount of £1,700.
What really happened aboard the Mary Celeste? Many believe that the answer lies with the ship's explosive cargo and the 9 empty barrels.
That many barrels of alcohol leaking into the hold would have created a lot of fumes.
Conrad Byers believes that on November 25th, the last day Briggs and his crew were known to be on board, the weather had finally cleared enough to allow the hatches to be opened.
Terrible odor in there. We'll have to vent the hatches.
I'll alert the captain.
I think immediately he sounded the alarm, knowing the dangers of this cargo and its chances of spontaneously combusting.
Overwhelming. What's to be done?
See to Tholby.
I think he planned to get everyone in the lifeboat and trail behind the main ship with the idea the cargo would either vent itself and cool off or explode.
You, man the peak. Come, let's go.
Conrad believes the sails were lowered to prevent the Mary Celeste from picking up speed once everyone had abandoned ship. A single rope was all that tied the lifeboat to the Mary Celeste.
What destroyed their plan, really, was that they didn't have time to get all of the sail off of the vessel. They piled into the boat and started trailing behind, and suddenly a gust of wind came up and started moving them.
When the Mary Celeste lurched forward, the lifeline snapped.
The vessel just sailed on without them and left them there.
The Mary Celeste drifted another 380 miles before Captain Morehouse found it. No trace of Captain Briggs, his family, or the crew was ever found. The Mary Celeste's fate was sealed as the most legendary of all ghost ships. Next, a newcomer to town is revealed as the mastermind behind a worldwide drug empire. West Glover, Vermont. This is where wealthy New Yorker Brian Brophill decided to buy a 30-acre farm to escape the big city. He told people that he had made his fortune manufacturing toothbrushes and had come to the country to settle down.
He loved Vermont, and he really became friendly with a lot of the local people. He had this easy way about him that made people very comfortable.
Bye-bye, baby.
Tough to part with this one? Oh, yeah.
Nancy Buckley met Brophill when he called about a puppy that she advertised in the local paper. Bye-bye.
He was open and friendly and was either knowledgeable in an area that you were interested in, or he was very curious and wanted to learn about something that you knew a lot about. And both of those things ingratiate him to you.
He was an accident waiting for a place to happen. He knew nothing about country life, but he was willing to learn. He was very obviously a city boy. He couldn't hide that.
Brophill impressed his neighbors by spending thousands of dollars on a special breed of horse called a warmblood.
He's wonderful.
Brophill then paid thousands more to board the horse with another neighbor, Peggy DuPont.
There were a couple of things about Brian that seemed a little strange. The first was that he paid in cash for his board. He had two horses, so he would pay me $500 in cash. And my husband immediately said, oh, he's a drug dealer. And I said, he's not a drug dealer, you're out of your mind. He's a nice person. And besides, he had to go to the bank first to get the money, he told me so.
Peggy's husband had no idea how right he was. One February day, 20 Vermont State Police, DEA agents, and U.S. Marshals paid a visit to Brofield's farm. The agents found a crop of more than 2,000 marijuana plants. Brofield was visiting Susan and Frank Madore at their farm in Virginia when a friend called with news of the raid.
There was a marijuana bust in West Charleston. They're looking for you, Brian.
He just was real calm and said, geez, I better make a phone call. So he went and made a quick phone call, and he came back and said, you're going to have to take me to the airport. He said, because I'm going to have to straighten this mess out.
He said that he was worried about his reputation and what is somebody trying to do to him, and this can't be right. I've got to get home and straighten out my reputation. I sincerely believed him.
The Madores didn't know that they were driving Vermont's biggest pot dealer to the airport. Brian Brofield then dropped from sight. Back in Vermont, authorities were just beginning to realize the scope of his operation.
The agent's initial reaction was just one of pure awe. Nobody's ever seen such an operation nationwide. It was one of the most sophisticated operations that has ever been seen.
Brofield's marijuana plantation featured automated irrigation and lighting. A heating system protected the plants from Vermont's hard winters. Authorities estimated that the operation had been taking in as much as $250,000 a month. Agent Andre LeBeer then contacted the international law enforcement agency, Interpol. He was stunned to discover that the giant marijuana farm was just a small part of Brofield's massive drug empire.
He got involved with a group of people who were living a good lifestyle. He traveled to a few exotic places with these people and got addicted to their lifestyle. He wanted to become a playboy. The quickest way he could do that was to become a narcotics smuggler. Initially, Brian traveled to Southeast Asia in the South Pacific, where he procured small amounts of narcotics. He would take these narcotics and tape them to his body and walk through customs. He did this in countries that execute people for drug activity. Brian would walk through customs without sweating a bead and making friends.
After months of work, Agent LeBeer was able to find an informant who was part of Brofield's work.
All right, this is what I found out. He's working on his mother load.
His mother load?
Yeah, his mother load. He talked about this one for a while. This is the one he's going to retire on.
According to the informant, Brofield planned to smuggle $20 million worth of heroin into the United States, most likely along the Oregon coast. But LeBeer could never pin down the exact place or time.
He confirmed our speculation that Brian is a major narcotics smuggler and is continuing to smuggle his narcotics. What we didn't learn is the specifics.
When all of this happened, I was in shock, and I just couldn't believe that he could live such a double life.
He lived this lie so perfectly that he obviously had no life of his own. The Brian that we liked did not exist.
Federal agents pursuing Brofield might have also thought that he didn't exist. 3 years passed with no sign of the fugitive drug dealer. Update. On the night this story aired, viewers in Paso Robles, California, recognized the fugitive as one of their neighbors. Authorities immediately moved in to make an arrest, but Brofield had vanished again.
Our understanding is that Brian watched the show. The show aired at 8 o'clock and Brian was gone at 8:15. He had left all his personal belongings behind and was just gone. He was living comfortably with no fears. We weren't even close to him. He could have wrote a textbook on how to hide. He was that good.
But not good enough. After Brofield left Paso Robles, tips from our viewers helped authorities track him to the city of Carlsbad in Southern California, where he was finally arrested. He was brought back to Vermont and convicted of the manufacture, possession, and intent to distribute narcotics. Brian Brophil served 7 years of a 10-year sentence and has since been released from prison. Next, a woman discovers she has two siblings that she has never met. And later, a trusted apartment handyman commits a brutal rape. On a previous broadcast, we brought you the story of Sue Scribner. When Sue was 13 years old, she learned of a secret that her mother, Calista, had been keeping for more than 15 years.
When I asked her why she had been crying, she told me about having a boy and a girl twin that had been adopted.
I think it's time I told you.
Told me what?
I was really surprised because I was 13. And it's a shock to find out that you have a brother and sister that you didn't know about.
The twins were both born with congenital heart defects, and Calista felt that she couldn't provide them with the care that they needed. 3 weeks after they were born, the twins were adopted. Calista never saw them again.
The twins being adopted, it just stayed with her forever. She never got over it.
For 10 frustrating years, Sue searched for the twins, but could never find any information about them. Update. 10 days after we featured this story, one of our viewers reported that Sue's brother and sister were living in Orlando, Florida. The twins had no idea that they had been adopted and were shocked to learn about the family they never knew. Finally, Sue met her brother and sister for the first time.
Doing good.
The reunion brought together 6 of the Scribner children and their families.
The very first time I met them, I think all of our knees were shaking. It is emotional, but I think we've all cried enough tears and we didn't need a lot today.
I can't wait to get to know them. I'm really very excited about it. And, you have all these questions in your mind. Gee, what did I miss out on all these years? What were they really like as kids?
So I think that my newfound family is wonderful. I think they're absolutely adorable.
You can lose me for another 50 years.
It's like we've known each other all of our lives, even though we haven't been around each other more than 5 hours.
She used to be small.
Doesn't really matter now what kind of life any of us had, because it's what's left that counts. We know where all of the children are now.
Our next story is about a courageous woman who was raped, who we'll call Deidre. Deidre has decided to come forward with the goal of finding her attacker and putting him behind bars.
Deidre lived on the Upper East Side in New York City. It's an expensive area, but Deidre had been lucky to find a rent-controlled apartment. She lived there for several years until the building was scheduled to be torn down. As the leases ran out, the tenants moved away. Eventually, Deidre was the only person living in the building, which was badly in need of repairs. In the end, it was one of those repairs, a leaky ceiling, that led to Deidre's violent encounter.
It's me again. Sorry, it's just a mess today.
The landlord hired a 31-year-old handyman named David Gause.
When he was first hired, it didn't seem strange at all. It was just somebody else coming in to do some work in the building. That's all.
After Gause fixed the ceiling, the landlord gave him more work. While doing the repairs, he lived in a basement apartment. At 9:30 one morning, Gause knocked on Deidre's door.
I thought you were coming up yesterday to paint the ceiling.
I had other things to do. I couldn't make it. I came up to borrow a frying pan.
Oh, okay. Just a second. Here you go.
Hey, what are you doing? Is it a joke?
No, it's no joke.
after he raped me, it seemed like he was calmer, but then he got a crazy look in his eye again, and he took an ice pick out of his pocket. I thought for sure that he was going to kill me.
Hoping to save her life, Deidre came up with a plan.
No, listen, you don't understand. Wait, no, we could be together.
I made him believe that he was my boyfriend. It totally disarmed him. He got really confused about the whole thing.
Here, I have this other money. Take this.
Really?
Yes, go find those guys. Pay them the money and come back. We'll go for breakfast. We'll be together.
Gause claimed that he needed the money to pay a debt. Deidre gave him all she had.
Right, just go.
Deidre's call to 911 brought an immediate response.
Pierre, I'm up here.
I'm coming right up.
But David Gause was long gone. The police background check on Gause turned up a long list of previous arrests and felony convictions, including armed robbery, assault, and grand larceny.
After we identified David Gause, I also contacted other police departments and learned that Gause was also wanted for a rape that occurred in Nassau County, Long Island. In that rape, he raped an acquaintance of his, and a warrant was issued for his arrest.
It still affects my life. I don't trust anybody. There's no enjoyment left. I know that he's raping other women, and I know that other lives are being destroyed. I'd like to see him off the streets. I'd like to see him put away forever.
Rape is a crime that is usually repeated until they're caught and put away. So there's no doubt in my mind, if David Gause is not caught, that he will go on doing what he's used to doing, raping women.
Update. After the story aired, we received numerous tips from our viewers reporting that Gause was living under the name David Johnson in Laurinburg, North Carolina. He was then arrested at his home.
Part of the healing of a rape victim is the person being apprehended and her getting her chance to gain her power back. I was happy for the victim's sake that after 5 years, she now gets a chance for justice in the court system.
David Gause was returned to New York, where he was convicted of rape, sodomy, burglary, and robbery. Gause was sentenced to a prison term of 20 to 40 years and will not be eligible for parole until 2017. Coming up, a man has only one clue to the identity of his father, a monogrammed handkerchief. Previously, we brought you the case of 18-year-old Lisa Marie Kimmel of Denver, Colorado. Lisa left home on a Friday afternoon to visit her boyfriend in Cody, Wyoming, and her parents in Billings, Montana. That night, a Wyoming Highway Patrol officer stopped Lisa for speeding about 60 miles south of Casper.
I was patrolling southbound on March 25th. I noted a small car northbound at 88 miles an hour, according to my radar. I turned around and pursued the car. I stopped her near Orange Junction.
Hey, Miss Kimmel, I had you on my radar back there at 88 miles an hour.
Lisa signed her ticket and drove off, but she never arrived in Cody. As days passed with no word, her family began to fear the worst.
As the week went on, we realized the gravity of the situation. The outlook was looking a little grim, but even if the outcome wasn't as we hoped, we still needed to find her.
1 week after Lisa disappeared, a man fishing on the North Platte River in Casper found a body in the water.
She was found nearly nude. She was sexually assaulted. There were some stab wounds in the chest area. And I can't tell you how they were done to the body, but it would lead the appearance that somebody took their time in doing this. It's hard to understand why somebody would do something like that to another human being.
Police discovered Lisa's blood on an old highway bridge a quarter of a mile away. They suspected that the killer had bludgeoned and stabbed Lisa there, and then dumped her body into the river. There was no trace of Lisa's car. Update. 14 years after Lisa Marie Kimmel was murdered, authorities cracked the case. Their check of the Wyoming DNA database matched an inmate named Dale Wayne Eaton, who was in prison on a weapons charge. When police searched Eaton's property, about an hour's drive from where Lisa was last seen, they found Lisa's car buried underground. It had been there for 14 years. They also learned that Eaton had kept Lisa at his house for 6 days. A jury found Eaton guilty and he was sentenced to death. Lisa's parents were awarded Dale Eaton's property in a civil suit. They burned all the buildings to the ground on what would have been Lisa's 36th birthday.
Clues about family history can turn up in unlikely forms. For a man named Charles Steuben, the clue was embroidered on a handkerchief that was tucked away in a dusty old file more than a half a century old.
Los Angeles, California. Charles Steuben was born in 1935 and grew up an only child. When he was a teenager, Charles discovered a clue that made him question his place in his own family.
I found a photo of my parents together on vacation in 1935. The picture is annotated September 1935, but my mother's not pregnant. So I began to think, well, if I was born on the 17th of September, it would have to be after that. But we know that a woman who's just had a baby, first of all, is not gonna go on vacation, and she's not gonna leave the baby behind. And so that's odd. But when I found it, I was probably a teenager, and I just, oh, that's interesting, and filed it away in the back of my mind.
When Charles earned a Navy College scholarship, he wrote to the State Department of Public Health for a copy of his birth certificate. When it arrived, he was disturbed to see that it was mostly incomplete.
There's some stuff missing here.
I noticed that too. I think it's sometimes when it's a copy, they just don't put everything in.
There was no hospital listed, no city, no attending physician, and no time of birth.
There were more blank spaces than filled in spaces. I said, this is a funny looking birth certificate. How come this other stuff isn't there? And my mother didn't know quite how to answer my question.
Mom, they don't even say what state I was born in.
Charles began to suspect that he had been adopted, but could never bring himself to ask his mother again. Charles was 54 with two grown children when his mother passed away. He decided that it was time to try to uncover the secret of his past. A family friend finally told Charles that he had indeed been adopted. Charles visited the Children's Home Society in Los Angeles, where the adoption had been handled in 1935. He had no idea what his file would contain.
In the envelope was a handkerchief, which had been found with me back in 1935. On the handkerchief, a purple W had been embroidered in silk. Here was a tangible connection with my past, that someone, probably my mother, had put this handkerchief with me as a kind of a token, a memento. To me, it meant that I'm sorry I got to do this, and maybe someday we'll get together again.
Charles' research took him back to September 25th, 1935. It was a typical Wednesday evening in Boyle Heights, which at the time was the Jewish neighborhood of Los Angeles. At around 8:30 p.m., a woman named Gladys Rossworm went out to move her car from the street to her driveway.
Oh my God! Oh my God! Oh!
The abandoned baby was only a few days old. He was wrapped in a blue blanket. Tucked inside was a linen handkerchief with the embroidered W. Gladys notified the Children's Home Society.
Thing, who put you here?
The baby was eventually adopted by a Jewish couple, Harry and Yetta Steuben, whom Charles would come to know as his mother and father. 55 years later, Charles still didn't know who his natural parents were or why they had abandoned him. He began searching through the Los Angeles birth records for September 1935. His only clue was the handkerchief.
The W was probably the last name of my father. This was a man's handkerchief, and it was the custom at the time for men to have embroidered handkerchiefs with their, you know, last name, the initial of their last name, embroidered on them. So that allowed us to narrow our search down to boy children whose last name began with W.
Charles placed several ads in the Los Angeles Times, and surprisingly, two different people came forward with the same information.
The most plausible story regarding how I came to be abandoned is probably that the father was probably Jewish and my mother was not. There was a businessman who was very prominent in the 30s and 40s in Los Angeles. This gentleman had a number of girlfriends, and it was quite possible that I could have been his illegitimate child. I'm sure that my mother was put under tremendous duress and having to make a very difficult decision in very trying times, and she did what she thought was best.
Charles never gave up hope that one day he would discover the truth about his birth family. Update. After this story aired, Charles was contacted by a viewer, Dr. Stephen Baskin. He recognized parts of Charles' story and suspected that he and Charles might be half-brothers. DNA confirmed their relationship. However, their birth mother, Rose Wasserman, has passed away. This photograph was found in her scrapbook. Charles believes that it may hold a clue to his father's identity. If you have any information, please log on to our website at unsolved.com.